Greetings, mobile accomplishers. Welcome to the Verge Mobile Show. We've been off for a week because I was at Apple, Dan was at a factory for Motorola, Chris was in hell, and Vlad was in heaven. But we're back, and I am Dieter Bohn.
I'm Dan Seifert.
And I'm Chris Sigler.
Is that a fair approximation of what happened last week, why we weren't able to broadcast?
I don't know what you guys are talking about. I wasn't doing anything. I was in bed watching sports.
Yeah.
Great.
Were you watching, what is that, Michigan football games?
No, AKA I was watching...
Hell. He was in hell. That's what I said.
No, I was watching professional bowling.
Oh, of course.
Oh.
Yeah. What else would I be watching?
Right. Naturally.
So, okay, we've got 2 weeks full of news, and of course, one of those weeks is the new iPhones. So while this snappy patter is fun, I don't care what you guys think and what your lives are like.
Dieter is just bitter because Minnesota lost late in the game on Sunday.
Dude, such a hard football game to watch. I mean, it was amazing. It was super fun, but you know that the Vikings are going to whiff it at the end, and they did.
Well, if you know it, then it's like, you know, we can seg this right into Apple's big announcement, where it seemed like we kind of knew everything that was going to happen.
Well, yeah, except with the Vikings losing, it's a terrible tragedy, and it breaks your heart, and it makes you mad at everybody. But with Apple stuff, I mean, I don't know if I'd call their announcements a tragedy at all. I think that, you know, there were no surprises, and that is kind of a bummer. You are always hoping for something, but I don't know if I'd say I was disappointed by what we saw. The interesting thing to me, well, I mean, two things. One, this was my very first Apple event, and that was pretty crazy and pretty fun. It's a neat live blog to do, and not at all nerve-wracking to know that more people are watching the letters that I type out in real time than ever have before in my life. But yeah,
I would like to say that you did an excellent job live blogging. I was actually
very sweet of you.
I was
fishing for that.
I was cheating on at Motorola, and while I was there, which we'll talk about later, but I was watching the live blog, and it was great. So,
did you guys watch the actual keynote? Did you watch the live stream when they posted it later?
No, yeah, I watched our supercut, so I watched it all in 4 minutes.
I mean, the thing that was most surprising to me about the keynote was how quickly they blazed through iOS 7. Because we're recording this on Tuesday, I believe it's coming out for everybody on their phones tomorrow.
Phones and tablets. It's supposed to hit for iPhones and iPads tomorrow.
And, you know, it's a huge, gigantic change for a lot of people. And I kind of expected Apple to use this opportunity to, like, really, really re-educate people on what, you know, iOS 7 is and what they're trying to do with it and why they made the decisions that they did and so on and so forth. But they kind of blazed through it in, like, 20 minutes, maybe even less than that, so that they could get to the real show, talk about the 5C and the 5S. I don't know what people, like regular humans, are going to do when they see this giant update on their screens tomorrow. It seems familiar enough to me that I don't think anybody's going to panic, and I think people are going to like it by and large, but I'm surprised that Apple didn't sort of like set that stage a bit more.
I mean, I've had this kind of lurking, nagging paranoia of when my mother and mother-in-law and maybe my wife get updated to iOS 7. And the potential hours of customer support and tech support that I'll have to give them. But, you know, I showed some images of it to my father-in-law, and he was like, well, it kind of looks good to me, and it makes sense, and it's more colorful, and it seems like it's easier to read. You know, there are some major changes, definitely, with the aesthetic looks of things. And, you know, obviously there's new multitasking and gestures and things like that. But the core experience is still iOS, right? Like, you're still got your settings apps is the same, and your phone app is essentially the same, and your messaging app is the same. They just look with a different coat of paint.
Right. All right, well, let's... So, iPhone 5S, iPhone 5C. Obviously, the most important thing to talk about with both of these phones is that the S and the C are lowercase and not uppercase.
It's the bane of copy editors everywhere.
It's just, I've been training myself so well to uppercase an S whenever it's in a product name forever and ever, and now...
Didn't this happen with the 3GS where Apple announced it and it was like iPhone 3G space S, and then later on they changed it to remove the space? I recall this happening.
Yes, that's exactly what happened, and it was the worst.
So I don't know if that's going to happen here where they suddenly become uppercase, but...
Right. Chris Ziegler, are you live?
Sorry, I'm being pulled into some operations of the site. I apologize for tuning you guys. I swear I'm not intentionally ignoring you or this conversation. I've been pinged through diplomatic back channels, shall we say, that require my attention.
All right. Okay. So the other thing that was surprising to me about this event was we had two phones. We had the 5C and the 5S. And we knew everything about them. That's fine. And we'll talk about them in more detail. There are a few things that we didn't know about the 5S, but regardless. We all kind of, in our heads, expected the 5C to feel like the bigger deal. And in fact, Apple has been promoting the 5C way harder than the 5S. And maybe that's just because, like, we know that they're going to have more inventory of that. But in terms of actual reader interest, it's all on the 5S. Like, the 5C is cool and interesting to us as, like, a nerdy phone industry story. And it'll be cool to a certain group of consumers that just, you know, want to get the cheaper model and want to get the pretty colors. But in terms of, like, you know, the core readership at The Verge, they really were paying most of their attention to the 5S.
Yeah, and honestly, I'm not surprised with that at all. The 5S is, as far as on a device level, much more interesting to me as a you know, someone who's really into this stuff than the 5C. But I don't think we should discredit how big the 5C is going to be for Apple. You know, even when we look at the sales over the past year with the iPhone 4 and the 4S and the 5, Apple and the carrier partners all admitted that 4 and 4S sales were still making huge numbers for them, and you know, they were still a big part of their quarterly sales. The 5C being priced where it is, being that it's flashy, it looks very new. You know, the people that are coming into the store that are, you know, able to renew their contract, whether it's, they're not going to be the people buying it on Friday. They're going to be the people buying it in November and December and January and March and April when their contract runs out and it's time for them to upgrade to a new iPhone. Maybe they had the iPhone 4, maybe they had the 4S. The 5C looks new and flashy and it's lower price than the 5S. They're going to sell a ton of them.
But to be very clear, like, if you own an iPhone 5, you're not in the market for a 5C.
No, and I think that if you own an iPhone 5, you're not eligible for an upgrade anyways. So you're not the person.
No, that's not true. On AT&T, you are eligible for an upgrade.
I know where you're going with this, Dieter. Yeah. I got that same text message. I might still have it on here. I have to read the text of it. It's hilarious.
But the point is, the people that are buying a iPhone on launch day and are paying full price for it are not going to be buying a 5C. They're going to be buying a 5S because they want the latest and greatest. That's why they're there on launch day to buy the phone. But the rest of the world, the vast market of consumers that, you know, don't even know when the new iPhone is available, the 5C is, I think, going to be, you know, hugely appealing to them.
You know, this is going to sound really stupid. The 5S, generally speaking, I'm not super excited about because the iPhone 5's camera is already superb. It's plenty fast. The 64-bit aspect of it doesn't appeal to me yet. It might 2 years down the road, but right now it's not quite yet important. But the singular thing that makes me want a 5S is not having to enter my Apple ID every time I update or buy an app. That is literally the only reason I want a 5S.
So I'm the exact opposite. Like, that's kind of like a cool add-on to me, but the reason I want a 5S is for the camera. Like, the camera is the only reason that I want the 5S.
So, I mean, look, we've been saying forever and ever that the iPhone is the best smartphone camera, and a bunch of Lumia 1020 aficionados have given us a healthy amount of shit for that opinion. is there such a thing as a healthy... Anyway. but, like, it really is. It's the one that, like, you need to have this balance of, like, quickness and, like, the ability to not have to think about something, think about your shot, and quality that the iPhone hits that spot really well. And so I'm actually really excited for the camera on the 5S. I haven't decided if I'm upgrading my 5 or not, partially because I spent the money to get my 5 re-anodized in orange. but, you know, like, when I want to know that I've got a quality, good camera on the phone that I am going to have in my pocket for the day, I, 9 times out of 10, will put my SIM into an iPhone 5 and then pray that tethering will still work because AT&T is the worst about provisioning. But, and so, like, that's appealing to me. The thing that is interesting to me about the 5 is this M7 processor, the 5S. I think we had heard something about there being some kind of improved motion sensing on it, or had we not? I can't remember.
Prior to announce, I don't know if that was a rumor or not. I don't think so.
But, I mean, I haven't really carried a Fitbit. I have a Pebble, but it doesn't have motion tracking on it. I've never gotten into, you know, Fuel Band or, you know, the Jawbone Up or any of this stuff. Because, you know, I know that I'm lazy and I don't exercise enough. I don't need an extra gadget on my wrist to tell me that. But having it built into the phone makes more sense to me. Like, I don't want to have to carry out another giga if I don't have to. And it makes sense to just have it there in the phone, and it'll just do the things that I want on its own. But apparently not automatically, because I guess Apple's not shipping anything built in that will utilize that, but they're making it available to third parties, so we'll see the Nike app pretty early on.
Yeah, I don't think, correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't think that the M7 has anything to do with necessarily more precise measurement of movement, either with the accelerometers or gyroscopes. I think it's just that it is going to be able to actuate those functions at a very, very low power.
Right, it without spinning up the main processor, which, I mean, the net effect is that you're able to do that motion tracking. I mean, even like, you know, the Fitbit and the Jawbone Up and all this other stuff, it's not like they've got, like, crazy things in them. It's, you know, it's basic sensors that track it. It's just that they're low power.
It sounds to me very similar to what Motorola did with the Moto X and their X8 system. They've got these dedicated processors that, you know, on the Moto X, it's doing the voice recognition and, you know, the motion for the gestures, but they're dedicated to that. And it seems to me like the M7 is taking that idea or approach and offering the data from the accelerometer and GPS, et cetera.
The difference there is that I actually have faith that the iOS ecosystem will take advantage of the M7, whereas with the Moto X, the only thing I ever expect to be able to do with its, you know, motion sensing mini core, whatever the hell we're calling it inside the X8, is to be able to twist my phone to bring the camera up. Like, we're never going to see an ecosystem built around
that. You pick up the Moto X, it knows you picked it up. That's a pretty cool feature.
Whatever. No, I go back and forth in active notifications. I turn them on, I turn them off, because it's an extra step to unlock your phone, which is a huge pain. Which is, again, like the fingerprint sensor, I'm actually really interested in that. The thing I wonder about...
Why aren't you using... why aren't you using the skip?
Because it's slow as hell. Because you, like, you tap it on and you wait, like, did it unlock? It's super slow. It's not good. Don't like the skip.
Whatever, man.
Hey, man. It's as slow as your video feed is right now.
Chris is currently moving at, like, 3 frames per second for us.
So, okay.
Chris is already using slow motion.
Are you guys getting one?
Yeah, I'm going to get one. I go through this emotional thing every single year, and before the announcement, I take the approach that, oh, if all these rumors come true, you know, I'm not going to be that excited about it when they announce it, and I'm probably not going to buy this one, and, you know, I'll wait for the next one. And then it gets announced, and I'm like, oh, that's cool. And then there's about a day where I'm like, I'm not going to buy it. And then, like, day 2 or 3 after the announcement, it just, like, hits me, and I'm like, yeah, I'm going to buy one. That's how it goes every year.
I'm leaning no for now, because I've got a 5 and I'm pretty happy with it. And if anybody who has a 5 asks me, I'll probably tell them they can live without it. But if you're older than a 5, like, you should probably seriously consider it. Like, if you're on a 4 especially, but even a 4S, the 5S would be a huge jump up.
I will say that the thing that's swaying me over to the buy side is the fact that in my household, my wife and I are on a plan, and our upgrades kind of, like, leapfrog each other. So every year comes up an upgrade on our account, and of course, being the awesome gentleman that I am, I take it for myself. And she gets whatever device I had prior to this. So I have an upgrade on my account. I can upgrade to the 5S, and I can pass her my 5, and then she has my 4S that I bought 2 years ago, which I can trade in for over $200, which sucks up a lot of the retail costs that I would be spending on the new 5S. So if I couldn't do that, and if I had to pay $750 full retail or even $300 out of pocket for an upgrade, I'd probably be thinking a lot harder about it. Being an iPhone 5 owner.
Right. Chris, are you upgrading? Chris is gone. He's in diplomatic back channel.
I'll tell you how Chris will go too. Chris will say no. Then the day of, he'll buy it.
No, he's gonna say no. And then the day of, he'll find that he can't buy it because it's sold out because we're expecting it's gonna be very limited supply. And then he will spend. Oh, he just.
he was not taking that abuse from you, Dieter. And he said, "I'm gone. I don't have to deal with this. I don't need you criticizing my buying habits. I'm leaving."
Well, that makes me actually feel really guilty now. I feel really bad.
He did this. I could say he did this exact same thing with the Nexus 4, and then he went out to a store and paid an absurd amount of money to buy it. So,
yeah, Chris is claiming that he's having computer problems, but I don't believe him. I think that he's a liar. So the other thing, I mean, the 64-bit chip. I mean, we've got a really good report up there from Aaron. You should take a look at it. It's interesting, but it's more about like what's coming than what it actually enables on the iPhone 5S at launch day. I don't think it's going to make a huge impact on like day-to-day feel of the thing. It'll feel a little bit faster, but whatever. It still won't make the animations faster. I still think the animations in iOS 7 are a little bit too slow.
Yeah, from what I've seen, the folder animations are really, really slow and kind of like a hindrance to actually using the folders because they take so long to open and close.
Look, Chris, if you can't take a little light trolling, then why are you even here?
Can you guys actually hear me this time or no?
We can, yeah.
Wow. We are moving in the right direction.
So let me finish my troll real quick. So
okay.
He'll try to buy one on launch. He'll say he won't, but then on launch day, he'll break. He'll want to go buy one. It'll be sold out because we're expecting channels to be limited on the 5S. He'll go onto Craigslist or eBay and like a bunch of carrier stores. He'll find one, but he'll end up paying $800 more than he should for it. He will use it for 3 days and then go, this is garbage. I could just use my old one, and he will sell it.
You're not far off. That's okay. Pretty close. The only small tweak I'd make to that is that I will say I'm not going to get one, which is true. I'm not going to get one until about 9 or 10 p.m. on Thursday night. And then I will make plan. I'll set my alarm for like 5:30 a.m. and then line up at the Apple Store on Friday morning.
Yeah.
But otherwise, your description was spot on. Also, I would just like to welcome our many new viewers right now coming in from Yahoo, which is apparently just linked to us. So, really? If you're joining us from Yahoo, welcome.
And we're sorry.
Yeah,
and we're sorry.
The quality of what you're watching is not indicative of what it usually is. It's much, much worse than this usually.
Is it ironic that Yahoo is linking to a service on Google?
Well, it's not like Yahoo has an equivalent service.
This is true.
Right. Okay, so the 5C, I mean, you know, what's interesting there is everybody was expecting it to be cheap, but as we read in Tom Warren's report the day of the announcement, it's more that it's just colorful. And so it's like they're pricing it higher than I think anybody expected. And, I mean, in retrospect, it's like, well, we thought Apple was going to radically change gears. They kind of just subtly changed gears. They still want to make a healthy profit margin on this phone, and as far as I can tell, they're gonna.
Like I was saying earlier, I think the 5C at the end of the day is going to be Apple's bread and butter this year, and they're going to sell a ton of them, and they're going to make a ton of profit margin on them, and it's going to be immensely popular. But my question is, from when they just released their first commercial for it, all the pictures of it look really glossy and plasticky and kind of gross to me. Dieter, you actually touched it, right?
Yeah.
Does it feel as gross as it looks to me?
No, not at all. It's fine. I mean, it doesn't feel like ultra swank premium. It feels like, I mean, it's glossy, But I would say like build quality is at least on par with like the 1X, if that you're familiar with that phone. Like it I think Johnny Ive's quote was that it's unapologetically plastic, which is funny because Google had said that about I want to say the Nexus 10 maybe. Anyway, whatever. But it's good. I think the cases with the little holes on them are terrible. I'm really not a fan of them at all. But the phone itself feels fine. It feels, you know, it's a little bit thicker than the iPhone 5, but not so much that you're like, oh my God. I mean, you know, I think that all things being equal, the iPhone 5 I prefer to the iPhone 5C. But if they can make the iPhone 5C for significantly cheaper than it costs for them to make an iPhone 5, it's a win for Apple. And I guess it's a win for consumers because, yeah, you're getting something that isn't quite as sexy as a 5, but you get to pick your color, and that's kind of cool.
Bigger battery, too.
And a bigger battery, right. I hope it's a little bit more durable. I imagine it will be, but we'll see. I mean, we've seen iPods back in the day that looked fine, and then they got scratched, like, super fast.
I really do think that Apple painted itself into a corner with the iPhone 5. I think that my guess is that they probably would not have abandoned their classic strategy of just pushing last year's model down one tier, but the iPhone 5, like you mentioned, Dieter, is just so expensive to manufacture that they literally had no option but to create a second model that costs less to make. Because the 5S obviously looks exactly the same as the 5.
Except for the ring around the home button and the dual lens.
Yeah, right.
Speaking of the dual lens, since we kind of really ran over the camera really fast, I'm actually shocked that Apple is the first company to employ a system like this. You know, other phones on the market have had dual LED flashes.
Yeah, can you real quick like give us the layman's?
Okay, yeah. So the here I'll show you on my iPhone 5. You can see on my iPhone 5, it's got one little LED next to the camera.
Explanation over.
and the iPhone 5S actually has two, and one of them is a different color than the other one. And what Apple can do is blast both of them at the same time at various levels of intensity to match the color of the lighting in your room or wherever you're taking the picture. So that will make your flashes better balanced with the environment. You won't have those like ghostly white subjects and then like a pitch black background, etc. But it requires two LED flashes. And there's tons of phones on the market, a lot from Nokia, that have had two LED flashes on them for years. And I'm just shocked that especially Nokia, with it's such a huge focus on photography and quality of photography, that it hasn't implemented a system like this before.
Well, another thing to keep in mind is that because the 5S has a physically larger sensor, you'll also have, in theory, more flexibility for not using the flash.
This is true, but the thing is, like, you know, we've said this time and again that the iPhone does not race in the spec race, and you know, Apple did delineate or mention a lot of the specs of the new camera, but if you compare them spec for spec with like say the top of the line Android phones on the market today, or you know the Lumia smartphones, they still lose in the spec columns. The new larger sensor that the iPhone is using has larger pixels in it, but they're still not as big as the pixels in say the HTC One.
Yeah, but hang on. I mean, the 5S has got larger pixels, and it's at 8 megapixels, not at 4 megapixels. And I think that everybody has a higher degree of trust in Apple to...
You didn't let me finish.
Tuning right.
So the thing with the Apple is, it's everything is about the image processing, and Apple develops its own image processing chips and algorithms and everything like that. And so even though on paper the other cameras win with brighter lenses and bigger pixels and all these other spec features, the iPhone still takes better pictures for most people most of the time because the image processing is so much better. That's all I was trying to say.
That's fair enough. And it's funny, like I'm going to bring it back to the Lumia 1020. I mean, like, I can get great pictures of the Lumia 1020, but it's the same thing as with the 920. I just feel like I can't get them when I suck and I'm moving quickly and just like, oh, whatever, I just want a picture of this. I need to like tune it. If I could get faster like off the cuff photos and good ones out of the 1020, then you know, I would just end the conversation that it's better. But the iPhone is just a better smartphone camera. The 1020 is kind of just a better camera.
I don't know. Well, I also hate to say it, but it kind of still doesn't even really matter that the 10-20, you know, that, like, right. that whole conversation doesn't matter too much considering the huge array of great photo apps available on iOS that aren't available on Windows Phone. Most importantly, Instagram. And I know that there are things like Six Tag out there now that kind of close that gap, but still it's a hack, right?
Right.
So another thing to consider. I think that software is still more important than hardware overall anyway.
Man, I feel like there should be a lot more to say about the iPhone, but like it's a really good iPhone, the 5S's, and the 5C is a 5. But
what are your guys' thoughts on the gold color, which is not really gold, champagne or whatever you want to say.
Champagne.
It's fine. I'm more interested in the space gray.
yeah.
Like, why yeah. not? What they just made it a lighter gray. Like, that was what was cool about the iPhone 5, is we all said it looks like murder.
Right. I wonder if it had to do with the fact that you can even see, I don't know if you can see on the camera, on my iPhone, the fact that it gets scuffed so easily with the mm-hmm. dark paint. I wonder if the new slightly lighter shade of paint won't show scuffs quite as much.
Yeah, it wouldn't surprise me.
I'm going silver, by the way. That silver has like been I've been lusting after that for a while, so.
I might go gold just to troll you guys, not because I like it. I actually hate it.
If you go gold, Chris, you will be just fulfilling my prophecies from like 6 weeks ago.
Yeah, but it'll also be a pretty effective troll, I think.
I mean, I gotta say that I'm nervous to get the 5S because if the fingerprint thing is as fast and easy as I hope it will be, it will ruin me to have to use other phones that I have to unlock.
Yeah.
I'll just get mad.
My second favorite, well, I shouldn't call it my second favorite yet because I haven't tried Touch ID yet, but my current favorite is still the pattern unlock on Android, which I know is not super secure because if you hold the screen like at an angle, you can usually see the pattern.
Well, you guys don't use face unlock?
I forgot that existed. A few weeks ago, I was like, oh, that's right. Android can do this face unlock thing, because it's just, like, I totally...
Do you remember how big of a part of that, the announce of Android Ice Cream Sandwich, the face unlock section was? Like, it was like this, like, 10 to 15 minute demo in their event.
With Matthias.
I'm going to set it up right now. No, I'm not. iOS 7, they fixed a couple things. We already talked about it, like, but it's cleaned up a bit. It's still... they fixed the lock screen. Like, my biggest complaint was they had that little arrow for Command Center, and now it's a horizontal arrow. It's easier to figure out when you first open it up. Because I was still doing it. Like, I knew how to do it, but whatever.
Yeah.
I think that I'm really kind of anxious and apprehensive to see how it's going to be on the iPad. Everything that I've seen from the iPad and that people have talked about using it on the iPad is that it is nowhere near ready. So
really? I'm not worried. I mean... nothing's going to be majorly different.
Well, I mean, especially on the iPad mini, because of the resolution and the fonts being thinner and everything kind of like that.
And the processor. At this point, the iPad mini has the slowest processor in the entire iOS range of devices, right?
Right.
I guess they still sell the iPad too, but...
Can we take a moment, as long as we're talking about the iPad mini, this is nothing to do with anything, to complain about Where's My Water 2?
Sure.
Go ahead, Dieter.
It's a free game, but there's in-app purchasing. Okay. Fine. You know, whatever. But the problem is when you buy a game that you know is going to have in-app purchasing, you have no sense of what it's really going to cost you to like finish the game and do everything that you want to do. And like, will you be able to do it for free? How much pain will it be? Who knows? They're constantly asking if you want to post stuff to Facebook. No, I don't. You can apparently get some power-ups and benefits by, like, bugging your friends on Facebook about this game. I don't want to do that. It has a energy bar that limits how many levels you can play at once, and then it fills up again over time. And then you can pay a buck to keep playing.
Oh, my God. It's like an arcade game. Wow.
You get to, like, this barrier where you can pay a buck to unlock to get the next levels, or you can, like, spam your friends instead to, like, get them maybe to help you get past this thing. It's not really clear. And then you can buy all these other power-ups, whatever. And then, but the biggest hassle, the hugest pain for me is, one, I don't know how much it's going to end up costing if I really want to play this thing to the end. And two, this energy bar thing. Like, I can play it for 20 minutes and then, like, sorry, come back in 10 minutes. Like, really? Like, just let me play your stupid freaking game. I don't want to pay a buck every 20 minutes. And that, well, okay, no, there's a thing. There's an in-app purchase where you can get a longer power bar. So maybe that means I'll be able to just play as long as I want. And I won't really run out of time and everything will be fine, right? That's fine. I will give you the money for the extended energy bar so I can keep playing your stupid game. Guess how much that costs?
$10.
$17.
Oh, my God.
How do you come up with 17, by the way? $16.99. Like, not $19.99, not $9.99, $16.99. Where does that come from? You know, I respected you, Disney. I mean, look, Where's My Water was amazing. And then you did Where's My Perry, and it's like, fine, whatever.
I mean, if we're talking about Disney here, they charge like $40 for a DVD. Or for a Blu-ray disc. Whatever movies come on these days.
And then Where's My Mickey was great. Where's My Mickey, really nice art on that one. But now, man, it broke my heart.
I'm a little concerned about your choice of titles, Dieter. I feel like you're strictly playing games in the age 2 to 5 market.
Well, he's already
dominant
dots.
In letterpress. I am the king of dots. On the new mode that you just get 30 moves and you just chill out and you don't have to be twitchy and fast. I think I'm at 455, which is pretty good. I'm pretty proud of that score.
This is why I can't play dots, because every time I play, it kicks me to the high score screen and it shows Dieter up there with like 617. And it's like, your last game was 212. And I'm like, this is why I don't even bother.
I will say this about free-to-play, though, because, you know, I know that Andrew, our games reporter, has some very strong thoughts about free-to-play as well. But, you know, Plants vs. Zombies 2 is obviously one of the year's big free-to-play games.
Right.
And I'm a little obsessed with it. I have not spent a dime on that game and have unlocked, you know, basically all of the power-ups and have gotten every star on every level. So it's like,
some games, some free-to-play games, you just like, if you're just good at it or you work at it, you don't need to pay.
You pay with time, yeah.
Right? But like, other, like, Where's My Water? Like, no matter like what you do, they're going to like get you, or you have to sit in the penalty box and wait to keep playing.
Triple Town is the same way too.
Yeah. It's like, I want to know, like, there should be a screen, an info screen or something. This game is free to play. Here is what what the things inside the game cost, so that I can look at it and go like, you know, this is going to be garbage. This game actually costs $16.99.
I'm going to install Dots right now and beat you.
Really?
Yeah.
All right.
If you're able to do this, I promise to not troll you for the next 2 weeks.
You have to beat me in both modes, by the way.
Dan, that doesn't seem like a very strong offer.
I don't
like,
know, Chris. I spend probably half of my day trolling you.
That's true.
I just want to say that since I started my Where's My Water rant, our viewer count has gone up, so the people are with me. The people believe.
The only thing I could say about these free-to-play games is I was kicking around in the App Store the other day, and I was looking at the top grossing section, which I still don't understand why that's made visible to players or to users. But and of the top, I think, 38 apps, there was only one of them that you had to buy, and it was whatever the Minecraft is for iOS. Right. It was like $6.99. Every single other one of them was free-to-play with in-app purchases. So clearly developers are making bank on these, and I think Apple's making bank on them as well, because it takes a cut of all of those $16.99s that are purchased. But yeah, it's a big
thing.
Speaking
of bank and apps, Google has essentially thrown in the towel and given up on making Google Wallet happen. I mean, that's what it is, right?
Exactly. That's exactly what it is.
Right.
That was a great transition.
Yeah. So if you didn't know, Google Wallet is now, for years and years, the complaint was, oh, I want Google Wallet on my phone. I want Google Wallet on my phone. I can't get it. And Verizon's blocking it. Well, now everybody can get Google Wallet, but you can't actually get what you think of as Google Wallet. You just get like access to what Google has morphed Wallet into, which is like a general like access to their payment portal and to like send money to other people.
Yeah, you get like offers.
Right.
Well, they killed the Google Offers app, right? So they like rolled Google Offers into this, so you can get pinged with coupons, and you can send money from one Google user to another Google user. It's nothing like tap-to-pay?
The mobile payment, the tap-to-pay stuff is still only limited to a few phones. And it's basically dead, right? I mean, Google, like, somebody else will try. Maybe ISIS will actually be successful. PayPal is still trying to make it happen. But, like, Google has basically given up on that game.
Yeah, it's just, I'm shocked that, you know, Google ceded defeat on this, to be honest with you.
I think NFC is dead. Like, I'm increasingly believing that NFC is such a bag of hurt, to borrow the famous Steve Jobs quote, that it's just going to wither and die in the vine, at least in the U.S. I know that it's, you know, obviously a huge deal in Japan, and it's still a big deal in the U.S. with, like, cards, right? But it's never going to be a big deal for phones, I don't think.
Well, and I mean, you know, Apple doesn't care, and I think Apple's right not to care.
I mean, it seems to me that, you know, NFC will continue to be that thing that's used by Nokia and Sony to ease the pairing of their devices. And it's never going to become the mobile payment stream that people have been hoping it would become for the past 3 years.
Look, even Google has recognized that NFC isn't going anywhere. They just bought Bump, right? They bought the you can magically share contacts with somebody by tapping your phones together. That doesn't use NFC. Maybe it could. But it's like they detect the accelerometer boom bump of two phones that are in the same geolocation, and then that is enough to like send information.
Which is, what, when you think about it, is like genius the way that works.
Yeah, well, and it's, you know, that thing, that app has been around forever, and they also made Flock, which is a photo sharing app, which is whatever. And it's funny, like, as soon as Apple comes out with its AirDrop for iPhone, and Bump's like, yeah, you know, maybe we should just get bought, because so then they get bought up by Google. I have no faith that the NFC ecosystem is going anywhere. I have no faith that the mobile payment ecosystem is going anywhere. Everything is terrible. Nothing's moving forward. And we should all just go back to buying flip phones, because whatever.
Sounds prudent. Is that prudent.
The state of mobile right now?
Yeah. Yeah, pretty much.
Except for the Nexus 5. Did we talk about the Nexus 5 on the last show, or is that?
No, the Nexus 5 didn't exist. It still doesn't technically exist. Last week.
It was after KitKat. No, we talked about this in the mobile show, that they showed the Nexus 5 in the KitKat video.
Yeah, but now it's got FCC.
I don't think we did talk about that.
Either way.
After the mobile show?
I don't think we did.
All right, the last mobile show was September 3rd, so.
Boom, I just got 120 in dots. Suck it.
Nice. 120. Nice. Yep.
Did you know you can draw squares?
What? Oh, do you get more points for that?
Dieter.
Anyway, that's my best.
Wow. Good job.
Thanks.
Very impressed.
So, anyways, this Nexus 5 that's been revealed by these FCC docs appears to be a redressed LG G2, right?
Right.
Very similar.
But isn't the screen a different size? It's 4.95 instead of 5.2.
Yeah, you're right.
And like the buttons are on the back.
Even though the screen is bigger than the Nexus 4, the overall shape of it from the mock-ups that we've seen of people like doing the Photoshop and getting it figured out right, it's actually not that much bigger than a Nexus 4. So you'll get a bigger screen, hopefully with smaller bezels, in a similarly sized package. And the Nexus 4 is sold out in the Google Play Store in the U.S. They sold out of the 16 a week and a half ago. Now they're sold out of the other one, the 8. So they're out, and they're not going to restock them. It's all over. So they got to be releasing something soon.
What's weird to me is that the Nexus 4... they put some actual thought into the appearance of it with that cool glittering back.
That was LG's doing. Come on. On all the other Gs at the time, all the Optimi.
LG hasn't done since, which is odd. But
they didn't look like that, did they?
They had. Yeah. They didn't have exactly the same thing as the Nexus, but they had little glittery things. In fact, one of them looked like Optimus Prime's Transformer symbol.
Well. Anyway, my point is, and this could obviously change since it hasn't been announced yet, but the leaks we've seen of the Nexus 5, it just has this really like drab, matte black finish, which just, I mean, it could not be any less interesting.
Well, if it is based off the LG G2 with different, slightly different screen, the G2 has a bland plastic glossy back. I'd much rather have the matte back.
Would you also rather have the back buttons? Have you seen the... There's a new G2 commercial that I've seen playing on TV now. And it's all about the back buttons. Like, people are going to watch this and be like, oh my god, buttons on the back of the phone, yes! And then rush down and to their carrier store and buy this phone. Like, it's... The commercial is completely insane. Like, there's like a woman in bed and like her phone is like laying like face down on the bed with her, and like the alarm goes off and all she does is press the button on the back and boom, it snoozes. Like,
that sounds like a lamer version of Motorola's new commercials.
Damn.
Yeah.
Oh, you do not have a G2 on you.
Of course I do. So there you go. There's the back buttons.
Dan has one of everything on him.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I'm more excited about KitKat than I am about the Nexus 5 at this point. Although I'll be interested to see if with all this LTE that's going to be packed into it, if they manage to get it, get any kind of carrier support for it, especially Verizon. If it'll work on Verizon, that'll be interesting. Interested to see if they'll be able to make it cheap the way that they did with the Nexus 4.
Speaking of Verizon...
My concern is the cost, but go ahead, Chris.
Can we just talk really quickly? I don't think we have it in our topic list, but I think
we're capable of talking really quickly about anything right now, but continue.
Well, we just need to hopefully very quickly bring up this nonsense today with Nexus 7 not activating with the LTE Nexus 7 not activating on Verizon. And there's this tweet. Jeff Jarvis tweeted at Verizon support, I think. And Verizon support tweeted back and said, let me read the exact tweet because it's insane. The reply is... Wait, hold on. I'm about to pull it up. The reply is... I'm excited you got your Nexus 7, but not all LTE tablets are created equal. It's not part of our lineup and can't be activated. Now, Verizon appears to have a fundamental misunderstanding of the 700 megahertz open access provision. And I was so fired up over that tweet that actually, like, I tweeted at FCC and VZW support in the same tweet. I'm like, you guys need to, like, have a little conversation because
Did you DM the FCC and be like, what's going on over there, man? You got to put Verizon in check.
Yeah, I probably should have. I'm saving that power for a very special occasion. Like, you know, when, like, a merger is about to go through that I don't want to go through, I'll DM FCC, be like, can you just nix this? And I haven't done that yet. But, like, this is not the first time that Verizon has just pretended the open access provision doesn't exist. And it's like, I think they're hoping that at some point the FCC will forget,
so,
which would be a very fair, like, expectation, because the open access provision has meant very little in practice. But the one thing it does mean is that this LTE Nexus 7 should work on 700 megahertz.
So I think
Google at the launch of the Nexus 7, I asked, so this is going to work on Verizon? Yeah, well, how did that happen? Well, we talked to them. Like, they supposedly set up a, you know, it's okay for us to have our tablet on your network deal with them. So, like, that fell through. But, I mean, you guys, like, heard me complain I couldn't buy just a raw SIM card to use in a Chromebook Pixel on their LTE network. So is this going to get fixed? Is anybody actually going to be able to?
Well, I think online? If you look at the Play Store right now, you can't buy the Verizon compatible Nexus 7 LTE model. I think you can only buy the AT&T and T-Mobile model. And I think it's been that way for about a day or two or something like that. And as far as, like, you know, a customer bringing their Nexus 7 into a store and getting it activated, I have a feeling that the people that made the deal with Google are so far removed from the people that actually deal with activating the thing that I'm sure the message either didn't get passed down or the system wasn't set up to say that the Nexus 7 is approved for our network. I'm sure there was a ball that was needs to go a very long distance from where it goes from Google's words all the way down to the customer level, and it got dropped somewhere.
Well, and another thing that's really scary to me that no one has really ever been able to answer or address, and I'm not sure it ever will get answered or addressed, is that Verizon is starting to stock up on AWS spectrum on which it will be deploying LTE to supplement its 700 megahertz network. The AWS spectrum is not subject to the open access provision. So you're going to end up with this hodgepodge LTE network where half of it, by law, must allow any device, and the other half doesn't have that restriction. So it's like Verizon could, if it wanted to, technically say, yes, you can use half of our LTE network with your device, which they may very well do.
I really don't think that this is Verizon being like, we want to protect this 700 megahertz spectrum. I honestly think that either the device didn't get approved by Verizon Systems and Google wasn't aware of that, or,
so,
you know.
Stop right there. Like,
communications broke down. That's
you're probably right that Verizon's bureaucracy of getting devices greenlit on their network and getting all the customer service reps to understand what can and can't be activated on their 700 on their LTE network, that bureaucracy didn't happen. It was a breakdown. It wasn't a fundamental, oh my God, what's going on here? Like, I'm willing to grant that's possible, but the fact that such bureaucracy needs to exist in the first place means that it's broken. Should be able to just say, I have a SIM card, I put in a device that's from your network, I put it in my device, I turn it on, and, you know, we set up a billing relationship and we're done. So that's what it ought to have been, and that's supposedly what they're supposed to do on the spectrum. Am I wrong?
Yeah, that was the idea. That was the entire spirit of that provision that was added to that block C, is it, I think?
So maybe it's time for Google to man up and, you know, do what they originally did when they pushed to make these open access rules happen, and then they totally backtracked on all of it with the Droid and got in bed with Verizon. It seems like the Google and Verizon aren't really BFFs anymore, so Google should start pushing again.
Yeah, but again, like, the best case scenario from a legal perspective is to say, well, on a fraction of your LTE network, you must allow all devices, which is just like really kind of anticlimactic. But I agree. Like, that's something that should still be doable. It's FUBAR.
Not to defend Verizon at all, but, you know, as Dieter can attest, you know, very similar types of situations happen on AT&T all the time when you're switching devices. Just as Dieter mentioned earlier, getting tethering to work on your iPhone when you switched your SIM in from an Android phone is a general nightmare, just because their systems are designed to screw you and not allow you to just switch devices at your whimsy. So.
Am I whimsy?
Your whim.
It is whimsy.
It's a whimsical move.
Yeah.
At your whim.
I mean, whims and whimsy, they're related words, so you're still fine. It's okay. Man, we've been going a long time. Dan, you visited the opening of the Moto X factory in Texas.
Yes.
Amazing. You got to see Governor Rick Perry.
I saw Governor Rick Perry spike his iPhone on the ground. And an aide quickly scooped it up.
Right.
When I spike my phone on the ground, I don't have an aide that picks it up. That's really disappointing. Now
I feel like you should be a governor of one of the biggest states in the country then.
I should be.
So they dedicated this factory in Texas, which is actually owned by Flextronics. Motorola contracts Flextronics out, and they assemble the Moto X there before shipping it out to customers in the U.S. The factory has actually been running since, I think, August 6th is the date when they started really ramping up the operations of it, but they dedicated it just last week officially, and they made a big deal with the governor and all the local officials, and Eric Schmidt was there, and for whatever reason, Mark Cuban was there. It was not filming an episode of Shark Tank, so I'm not 100% sure why Mark Cuban was there, but he was there. And it was cool. I got to see, you know, where they were putting together the Moto X. And it's the thing that struck me about this was how much human manpower is used with this. When you think of, like, modern or current, like, type of factory systems, most of us, at least I do, I think of an automotive factory where there's big robots and, like, drills and all this other stuff putting things together. But a lot of this stuff is actually done by humans, putting together the phones and packing them up and shipping them out. So there's a big photo essay.
Yeah, what struck me, the photo essay was awesome, by the way, and I think that that everyone really loved it. But my question is, do these people really stand on their feet for 8 hours at a time?
So there's a lot of questions about that. Actually, what they're on now is 2 12-hour shifts. So the factory runs 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and the shifts are 12-hour blocks at a time. And Motorola said that they were switching to 8-hour shifts in the very near future. But by labor laws, at least here in the U.S., you do have to afford breaks every, certain amount of time, and they have to have meal breaks and things like that. So, they're on their feet a lot of the day, but they're not standing there continuously for 12 hours at a time. And while I was there, I saw quite a bit of movement between the various factory workers switching positions and going on in their breaks and going to lunch and things like that.
Yeah.
And then they also are on pads. They're not just standing on, like, a concrete floor.
Oh, that's something, I guess. But still, man, that would be intense. I wonder if that's, like, is it more efficient for them to stand than, like, if they had seating level desks that they worked on? I guess they wouldn't have as much reach.
Yeah, when I was observing them, a lot of their jobs, from what the ones that I could see and observe, were taking, moving from one part, like, you know, physically moving things from one end to the other. And they did have to, like, you know, reach and stand and walk a fair amount. So they're not just, like, standing still. A lot of them were moving back and forth quite a bit.
Yeah. And do we know when we're getting the wood cover?
I was told that it will be coming in the future, but not in a long future. Not in a long while. One of Motorola's executives told me that it's sooner than you think, but he wouldn't tell me when. Which...
So when you say not in the long future, you mean like in the very near future we'll see it?
Yeah, hopefully.
Okay. Yeah, because I would probably be into that.
Yeah, so would I. I mean, if Motorola announces on Friday that you can buy a wooden Moto X, there's a definite real chance that I might buy two phones on Friday.
Well, you know what's better than a wood back is a fake leather back with fake stitching. So that's actually, I didn't mean to try to segue into the Note 3, but I may have accidentally done that.
So here's the thing about the Note 3. There's nothing about the Note 3. take the Note 2 and make it thinner and put some stitching on it, and like, what else is there that, you know, matters? They just made it bigger.
It's faster.
Thinner.
I guess.
Faster.
Yeah, and it has a fake leather back with fake stitching.
Which has to be an intentional troll, right?
A troll of buyers or of who?
Well, Apple gets rid of all the fake stitching in their
software. Apple said they ran out, right? I believe that was the line that they used in June, that they ran out of
Samsung
leather.
Samsung has it all now. Felt.
Yeah.
It's insane, right?
So this is an example of Samsung. Because it controls its supply chain from top to bottom, it squeezes out the competitors by just holding on to all the fake leather.
If it weren't for the Note 3, iOS 7 would still be skeuomorphic. Thanks a lot, Samsung.
Oh, thank you. Seriously.
Well, the one nice thing about the Note 3 is that it is compatible out of the box with the Galaxy Gear, I guess. Which...
Wow, you are just a transition machine today.
Well, I have nothing else to say about the Note 3.
Chris has things to do.
What more do you want to say about the Note 3?
There's nothing else to say about the Note 3.
I think we can sum it up this way. Is if you like the Note and you like the Note 2, you're going to like the Note 3. If the Note and the Note 2 were not your thing or not your cup of tea, the Note 3 is not going to be either.
I'll sum it up this way. If you wear cargo pants and nothing else, one, are you okay? Two, you're really going to love the Note 3.
Well, or if you're into hip holsters.
I mean,
holster guys love it.
If you wore cargo pants exclusively, though, I have to believe. I mean, why stop at a
Note? You must have
a
reason, right?
You must have a reason. But second of all, why stop at the Note 3? I mean,
get the Note 8, the Note 10.
Right. Exactly. The Note 8 has an earpiece on it, and right. You can definitely fit a Note 8 in one of the like leg pockets on a good pair of cargo pants. So, Just step it up a bit. Like, you know, you might as well max out your storage capability.
And then you can take all your calls from the Galaxy Gear.
Yes. Yes. By the way, I'm looking forward to never seeing people walking around with their hand up to their face talking into their Galaxy Gear, because that's not going to happen. But that feature does exist, and it's insane.
Yeah. So, Galaxy Gear. And there's also the Sony Smartwatch 2. They look pretty terrible to me.
They do, yes, for different reasons. I think that, like, if you look at the Galaxy, if you look at the Galaxy Gear from like the bottom three-quarter view, you're like, oh man, this is a pretty sweet looking watch. And then you slowly like rotate it around until the camera comes into view, and you're like, oh god, what is that? Like, that was my exact reaction.
The consensus within The Verge was that, I don't know who said it first, but that the camera looks like a boil.
That would be Josh.
I think I said wart, yeah. And then he was like, no, it's not a wart, it's a boil.
Yeah. Oh my god, yeah, ever since he said that, I can't get it out of my mind.
You can't unsee it, right?
No, and it looks exactly, I mean, that's such a great description. It's like, if you're used to either wearing a watch or looking at other people wearing watches, seeing this giant, like eye, it looks, I mean, literally looks like an eye staring at you from the band of the watch is really unsettling.
I have so many issues with the Galaxy Gear. I don't even know where to begin. What's funny to me is that I wear my Pebble pretty often, and when I see people I know and they ask about my Pebble, the first thing they say is that, oh, is that new Samsung watch thing? And really? So, like, yeah, people are, like, really curious about it, and they want to know about it and things, and then I have to tell them that it's not, and that the Galaxy Gear is kind of a mess, in my opinion, but...
I do not want, is all I will say. Do not want.
Yeah. My biggest issue with the Galaxy Gear is that it's a color LCD screen that is not on all the time, and you have to actually interact with it to see the time, which drives me nuts.
Not right. Okay. I mean, look, when did the Impulse, was it Impulse? No. The Android watch from CES, like, last year.
Oh, iMwatch.
The iMwatch, right? We all looked at the iWatch and said, here are the problems of trying to run Android on a smartwatch that need to be solved. And Samsung looked at all those problems that everybody who, like, even glanced at the iWatch listed and went, yeah, we're going to solve half of those problems halfway, and that'll be enough.
Battery and we're going to add a giant camera.
Looking at the screen, software quality, like, and then we're going to add a giant boil camera to it.
A creep shot camera.
And I think that, like, similarly, that there's very similar issues with the Sony thing. It's, you know, it looks fine, but, like, I'm sorry, a menu button on a watch.
I was about to say, it doesn't look fine. It looks like they said, you know what would be awesome is if your watch looked like a tiny smartphone on your wrist.
Yeah.
And then, like, they just scaled it down and left the capacitive buttons on the front. And that's not at all what a watch should look like. So these are both failures. And I think we all knew this was exactly what was going to happen, right? Like, these companies were going to completely misinterpret the wearables movement and come out with maximally feature-packed devices that missed the mark in some fundamental design-oriented way. And that is what has happened with these two devices. And I don't know if it's going to take... this is what, Sony's third or fourth... go at making a smartwatch.
It's at least a third. Yeah, least a third.
And they're not getting any closer to hitting the mark. The Galaxy Gear certainly doesn't appear to hit the mark. I mean, we won't know until we review it, but that boil alone is enough to turn me off. So I don't know who's going to get it right. I still think that maybe, you know, it's going to be someone like a Pebble or MetaWatch after all this time. I mean, don't get me wrong. The iWatch is going to sell, whenever it comes out, the iWatch is going to sell a billion, right? But a wearable device on your wrist. I don't think that they're going to make a product that looks like a watch, because if it looked like a watch, it wouldn't look like an Apple product.
Right.
Well, it's interesting that you say that, because if you look at how Samsung is positioning Galaxy Gear, I don't think it calls it a watch at all. I think in its press release, it says that it has watch-like functions in that it'll tell you the time, but nowhere does it call it a watch. It calls it silly things like a life companion or some other nonsense marketing
term. In the caption of the press release, I think they called it a wearable device.
Right.
Which is, you know, yeah, they were obviously very keen to
avoid. Is this implying that I need to wear a watch on my other wrist so that I can see the time?
That was the whole idea with swatches, right? You just, like, wear a bunch of watches? That's like, I'll do that, except with smartwatches. Sure, why not?
I can think of a few reasons why not.
Well, there was a picture that Vlad did at his hands-on with it, where he had, like, all the colors on his wrist at once.
Yeah, yeah.
It's pretty great.
Man. That's probably enough for this week. Well, no, I guess we should say Nokia has delayed the release of the 1520 or the announcement of the 1520, the giant 6-inch Lumia, which, like the Galaxy Note 3, I don't care about at all. Like, the problem with Lumias is not the size of their screen.
I know. that's like priority, like, 82 to solve. Right. Another thing, like, I actually hate the idea of a 6-inch Lumia so much that my, like, civil disobedient protest to it will be that I always refer to it as the Lumia 1520. So in any future podcast, I will be referring to it as that.
Nice.
Yeah, it looks terrible.
Just and then, I guess this shouldn't be a surprise, but Nokia was testing Android phones before they got bought by Microsoft. And Microsoft was moving forward with plans for a Surface phone before it bought Nokia. So that must have been some, like, awkward meetings once they, like, you know, got together. Like, so, what have you guys been working on?
Yeah.
Stuff.
I mean, it doesn't come as a surprise that Nokia had Android phones, you know, in its labs or whatever. But it does, it's still, when you hear it, it's still kind of heartbreaking.
Well, and they were doing it in two different ways, right? They were like, actually, I think they were genuinely thinking about, for the low-end line, for the Asha line, that they might want to switch to Android. And then they were just making sure that they could get Lumia stuff running on it just in case. But I think that it was more than just, like, something in a lab. They were actually, like, seriously considered doing something with it.
Yeah. I think I tweeted this today, that news break, that, like, if you could just imagine a Lumia 925 running Android and using a Nokia camera app.
Yeah.
It would be like Nokia saved. Not really, but, you know, it would probably blow my mind.
Yeah. No, I think that, I mean, as sad as it is to say, I think that would probably just end up putting them in the same position that HTC is in, where they're making amazing products and getting no traction with them.
Dude, I don't know. I think that they could make a better run of it than HTC could. HTC's having a hard time.
Yeah.
I think that Nokia would be able to stand up to Samsung a little bit better, but maybe still get crushed.
Yeah.
Instead, they got bought. So goodbye.
Well, maybe Nokia should put boils on your wrist.
Windows Phone puts boils on your wrist. Wow. That, gentlemen and ladies and gentlemen, is the Verge Mobile Show. It has been episode 62. If you're wondering. For the week of September 17th. Happy birthday to my brother. If you want to follow us on Twitter, you can. I am Backlon, Dan is DC Seaford, Chris is Z Power, Vlad is Vlad Savov. We are all at Verge. You can leave a comment on this very post. You can do it right now, this second. Just go. Just go and leave a comment. We'll read it. It'll be great. And we'll catch you next week. Thanks for watching.
Later.